Greetings from Philadelphia. I'm Pete Fader, the Francis Mpeiwon Cha Professor of Marketing at the Wharton School of the University of Pennsylvania. And I'm very happy that you're joining us for this inaugural Meet the Authors session under Wharton School Press. You know, I'm as a researcher, I'm very happy to get my ideas out there, write a lot of journal articles and things like that. But we want our research to have meaningful influence. We want decision makers to know about it. We want policy makers and others to be aware of the research and how it can impact them. That's the whole point of this series. There's a lot of folks, myself included, writing books to take our research and make it very, very accessible. And we want to promote that. We want to encourage that. And we want all of you to benefit from it as well. So here at the Wharton School, we've decided to institute this series. Today, we're going to have Michael Platt, a colleague of mine in the marketing department who happens to have appointments in three different schools at the University of Pennsylvania. I just want to give you a sneak preview. This is the first of four planned events for this year, and I hope many more to come. In March, Jonah Berger will be here to talk about his book, The Catalyst. Then in May, it'll be Katie Milkman to talk about how to change. And then in July, Mauro Guillen will be here to talk about his most recent book, 2030, as well as a new book that he himself is going to have with Wharton School Press. We really do want to take a deeper dive into the kind of research that we do and the way that it can really make the world a better place. But today, making the world a better place is Michael Platt, who, as I mentioned, has appointments in three different schools here at the University of Pennsylvania. He is a PIC professor. Penn integrates knowledge, which is really quite an honor, quite a burden to be able to integrate all that knowledge and spread it to so many different students and colleagues. Michael does a variety of different kinds of teaching and lots of work all across the university. He actually has a brand new course in Wharton Executive Education on the neuroscience of business. But in general, he just focuses on the brain and decision-making processes and some of the broader implications that arise from neuroscience and how it can affect not only the way that we make decisions, but in particular, how leaders can just run organizations more effectively. His book is called The Leader's Brain: Enhance Your Leadership, Build Stronger Teams, Make Better Decisions, and Inspire Greater Innovation with Neuroscience. So, Michael, it is great to talk to you. I want to have a little one-on-one conversation first, and then we'd really like to invite people to submit questions as well through the chat. Please type those in right now. We'll have time for them, and they'll probably be more interesting than anything I have to ask Michael. Michael, how are you doing?
I'm great. It's great to be here, Pete. It's great to see you. It's been a long time since we've seen each other in person.
Indeed. So we'll take the virtual. It's the next
best. Absolutely. Absolutely.
So let's talk about your book over here. You know, Michael, there's a lot of books on leading and leadership and so on. Do we really need another one? Like, what are you bringing to the leadership party?
That's a great question. Well, I think this is different because what I'm trying to do is to bring the lens of neuroscience to bear on leadership. So I think, you know, now more than ever, we all want to be better leaders, you know, at work and in our communities and in our homes. And we're at a point in the development of the science that neuroscience has something special to add. So neuroscience allows us to kind of take a peek under the hood in terms of what's going on in our heads when we make decisions, when we lead the people that we manage. And this allows us to get some novel insights that go beyond kind of traditional approaches, which are based on surveys and self-reports and observations of behavior. So, you know, the time is right. And, you know, and so I think it's, you know, was appropriate and really opportune to get this message out there.
So let's talk about that going beyond, because going beyond might mean not only adding layers to kind of existing knowledge about leaders and leadership, but perhaps even finding results, offering advice that might even contradict things that we've known before. I don't want to be too controversial here, although provocative is always good. What can you tell us about how neuroscience not only adds to, but changes, reorients some of our understanding about leadership?
Yeah, well, I think for any of the functions that we're interested in that are relevant for leadership, whether it's decision-making or innovation or how we connect with others, often our own sense of self is a bit limited, right? Our awareness of the chatter of the 80 billion neurons in our brains is not deep enough through introspection to really tell us what's going on. So that's where neuroscience can be really helpful. And what we're finding, and others in the field are finding, is that often there's a disconnect between what we might think is driving our behavior, or what a person might say or be willing to reveal. And so this can offer some provocative, I think, rejoinders to that. So I kind of wanted to tell you about a one case study I introduce in the book. And this is one where we look at the brains of Apple iPhone users and Samsung Galaxy phone users, right? So two biggest brands in the market here in the US. And when you ask Apple iPhone or Samsung Galaxy phone users, how much do you like your brand, your cell phone brand? How much do you identify with it? How loyal are you? They both say the same thing. But when you actually look inside their heads, and we did this by doing brain scans on them, we found that Apple users, they were closely identified with their brand. They had a social and emotional connection with Apple that was very similar to what you'd see in the way you'd relate to a member of your family, right? A loved one. But we didn't see anything like that in Samsung customers' brains at all. It was more of a sort of just a user, this is just a useful tool to me rather than a member of my family.
Very interesting. And as the only member of my family who doesn't use an Apple phone, I feel that all the time. So that's an example of kind of almost from a consumer standpoint. Tell us how that idea of literally getting inside the brain can impact a leader or leadership practices as well.
Well, there's so many different ways in which knowing something about how our brains work and the limitations on our brains, and also the differences in the way that different people's brains function, right, I think can be very, very revealing and very useful to any leader. So, for example, in the domain of decision making, there have been a number of Nobel Prizes given out over the past couple of decades for work in behavioral economics, showing that people are kind of irrational, right? So they show choice fatigue, right? Option fatigue. They can't tolerate too many options, or they're susceptible to decoy effects. And these kinds of irrationalities, so-called irrationalities, are often ascribed to just some quirk of psychology or something cultural. And the reality is it reflects real hardcore limitations on the way our brains work. Due to energetic constraints that make our brains work in a particular way. It's just kind of a rules our brain lives by, and you just have to deal with it.
Interesting. And it's not only the way our brain works on its own, but one of the things that you really feature in the book, and I know in a lot of your current research, is the idea of the social brain network. Something that sounds almost like out of some science fiction movie, but tell us what that is and what are the implications of understanding it.
Yeah, this is near and dear to my heart and to my research, which is, the fact, this is a true discovery over the last two decades in neuroscience, is that each of us carries around in our heads a network, which we call the social brain network, which is dedicated to managing our relationships with other people. And so, it kind of begins with perceiving who's around us and proceeds to kind of allow us to understand their emotional state, and also to form a mental model of what they know or what they think or what they might want or need. And those processes come together and allow us to decide what to do next. Should we help them? Should we cooperate? Should we stay away from them? And we now know a lot about how this network works, what turns it up and what turns it down, and how to maximize its effectiveness in any particular individual.
And I have a whole lot of questions about how this works and how we basically take advantage of it. And I'm sure that a lot of the folks watching us have questions as well. So please type those into the chat there. But just pursuing it a little bit further, you talk about the ways that people will really leverage the idea of the social brain. And some of it's kind of surprising. I mean, things like physical contact, eye contact. Tell us more about some of those cues and mechanisms that make the social brain more effective.
Yeah, so the social brain network is a heritage that we that comes from our ancestors, millions of years ago, who had to getting along with other people was critical for survival, and so the social brain network is something that's there, and it is operating spontaneously and continuously, and it has to have data to work on. So it's really important, in fact, to pay attention to other people in order to give your social brain network the data it needs to be effective. So if I were to close my eyes, you know, I can't tell what's happening with the people around me. That that same observation extends to the fact that if you're sitting around a conference table and you're looking at your phone underneath the table, you're starving your social brain network of the information that it needs, right, to acquire from the people around you to understand, you know, what they're thinking, what they're feeling, and what they might do next. So looking at people, paying attention to them is critical. And making eye contact is super important because it does a couple of things. First of all, it allows the other person to know a kind of, you know, subconsciously that they're important and that you're paying attention to them. And we also know that when you make eye contact with somebody else, this unleashes a host of processes in our brains that kind of turn up the social brain network, okay? And that is going to lead to higher trust, better collaboration, and better communication between us.
And you say it's not only eye contact with other people, but you even gain some of those internal benefits even when you make eye contact with your dog.
Absolutely. So, you know, as human beings, our species has domesticated dogs over the last 30,000 years by basically selecting dogs that pay attention to people. And so we've kind of harnessed the same mechanisms in their brains that are operating in our own when we connect with other people. And so there's really interesting data that shows that when you make eye contact with your dog, that this releases oxytocin in your brain and also in the dog's brain, and that's going to turn up both of your social brain networks and lead to a closer bond for you. And what I really love about this is you know, it kind of gives us an opportunity to pregame, if you will, before a really important meeting, or maybe before you go out on a date, which is like, if there's nobody else around, you grab your dog, gaze into its eyes, crank up your social brain network, and now you're going to be, you know, functioning at a higher level in terms of making connections with other people.
And a natural question, something that you do touch on in the book, is what do you do when you're on Zoom? So should you make contact with the other faces on the screen, or should you be staring at the camera?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, it was interesting to be writing a book when the pandemic hit, which caused me to, you know, have to confront a lot of these challenges that are in front of us in terms of the way we connect with other people now. And so when you're on a Zoom call, there's this real difficulty, because if I'm looking at you, Pete, on the screen, where you are is different from where the camera is, which is up at the top of the screen. And so if I want to give the impression that I am paying attention to you and I want to make eye contact with you, I have to look up there. So there's this offset, which you know, is really challenging. But I think there's a really important lesson here, which is that at those really key moments, right, when you need to communicate with folks, don't look at them, look at the camera, right, and communicate what you need to communicate, and just assume that they're going to respond appropriately.
And a couple of aspects of the social brain network are words like mirroring and synchrony that are less about, why don't you describe those, how they fit together and with this broader concept?
So another really amazing observation that is, you know, figured into our work recently, but it, you know, this has been established in multiple different research studies, is that when we have a close connection with another individual, our brains actually go into synchrony. So they start to resonate in time with each other. And this actually percolates down to the rest of a number of other physiological processes, like our hearts begin to beat closer in time and we begin to breathe closer in time. And so physiological synchrony, it turns out, is what we would call a biological marker or biomarker of a close working relationship. So that, think about that as a tool that any leader could use potentially to more effectively put people into good, you know, into teams that will work well together and to be able to monitor their progress. So it's super exciting, that observation. And there are a number of things that we can do, and these are things we're exploring, that seem to kind of turn up the volume on synchrony to get us into sync before we work together. So things like mirroring, actually, you know, this is something that, you know, people who do improv have exercises where they mirror each other's movements, and there's data that shows that that actually begins to get our brains in sync. And so I think that's something that actually you can do online. We don't have the data yet. Nobody was ready and prepared to actually give everybody brain monitoring devices while they were, you know, heading into lockdown. But I think it's something that's worth exploring.
Very interesting. I got one more serious question. I want to get into kind of the fun stuff. Still have a few minutes to go to submit questions. Love to get them. One of the things that you point out is that the traditional kind of the thing that everybody believes, the whole left brain, right brain distinction, you kind of debunk that. Tell us more.
Well, so let me put it this way. The metaphor is correct. The idea that there's sort of a yin and yang in your brain between focus and execution and getting the job done on the one hand, and thinking outside the box, being creative and being innovative. It's just not that it lives on the left and right sides of your brain. In fact, there is a dedicated circuit in our brains, which we now understand quite a bit about, that that's there just to get us out of routine, to push our minds into more creative spaces. And then there's a separate circuit that is involved in execution, focus, attention, getting the job done. And it turns out that when one of these is turned up, like you're sitting there in front of your computer, typing into you know, your email, or you're executing spreadsheets in Excel, when you've got that dialed up, your innovation network is turned all the way down. So in order to give that innovation network the opportunity to turn up, you need to actually disengage from those routine tasks. In fact, we now know that not just disengagement, but getting up, walking around, going outside, those are the kinds of things that literally free your mind, liberate that innovation engine in your brain, and will allow you to come up with new ideas.
And you really do it. You talk about getting up and walking around. You really do like to practice what you preach in terms of diet, exercise. You want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it is certainly with regard to disengagement. I mean, maybe it just reflects the fact that I've got a lot of energy, but I get up about every 15 or 20 minutes and go for a walk. And some of my best ideas have come, you know, walking back and forth from my house to work, which is about a mile and a half walk. But yeah, I practice a lot of what I preach here. So what I eat is very important to me. I mean, it is, you know, everybody in this country is kind of obsessed with diet, mostly for the purposes of trying to have a healthy body and to be kind of physically at their best. But it turns out eating the right foods is really critical for having our brains work at their best as well. Our brains are the most expensive organs in our body, so they demand 20% of the calories that we take in. But it's not just energy that our brains need. Our brains need nutrients because the chemicals that are important for regulating processes like learning and decision making and connecting with others, those chemicals have to be made from amino acids. And amino acids come in from protein. And so when you wake up in the morning and you've fasted since the night before, you're actually kind of depleted in a lot of these key amino acids. And so it's actually really important to have protein for breakfast. Don't go for the bagel. Don't go for the donut. You gotta go for the egg or what my go-to is a whey protein shake. I put a lot of chocolate in it because I love chocolate. But that's one way to make sure that your brain is ready to go.
Very interesting. I got one more question from me, then we're going to turn it over to the folks who are participating remotely. You talk about in the book the idea of matching the brain to the right job. And that, again, you can sort of see how the science supports it. But just looking ahead into the future,
yeah.
Do you think we're going to start seeing that kind of thing happening more routinely, whether it's for work or whether it's for positions on the sports field and so on? Talk about matching the brain to the right job.
Absolutely. So I think this is probably the highest impact area that neuroscience will influence, because we now know that there are a number of really critical functions that we've talked about, like, you know, your social brain and your innovative brain and your focus brain, your decision brain. And you can think of that as like each person has the dial on each of those functions set at a different level, like it could be a 3, it could be a 7. And we can move the dials, you know, through exercise and the right exercising your brain in a sense. But, you know, you're not going to take a 3 to a 10. You might take a 7 to a 10, but probably not a 3 to a 10. So understanding kind of where a person is, right, what their intrinsic talents, traits, and motivators are more precisely would be fantastic for empowering them to find the job that is a good match, right, for them. And so that's something that we've been investigating. I know there's a huge amount of interest in the business community even more so in sports. And I love sports as a kind of petri dish for business and for life because, you know, the margins are so slim. So if you can improve your performance by a few percent, that could be the difference between a gold medal and, you know, and not being on the podium. And so, you know, so if we can do that better and identify people who are going to be, let's say, better at a specific position in sports, think of how that could impact coaching and management decisions. It could make the difference of hundreds of millions of dollars. And we've got some really exciting data from professional athletes that shows that if we, you know, through a quick 10-minute gamified assessment, you know, in front of a computer, while we collect a little bit of brain data, we can actually predict lifetime career stats on the field, which is, you know, to me, that's amazing stuff.
Truly, truly. Wow. So I'm going to turn to some questions coming in. First one coming in from Instagram is asking, how do we stop our brains from talking ourselves out of taking on risks or pursuing unknown new opportunities?
That's a great question. So, I think, you know, it's clear that different people, you know, approach this differently. So some people are risk seeking. Some people are a lot more risk averse. There are things that we can do in terms of changing our environment. So we did a study last year that showed that that, you know, where we look leads to what we choose. Okay. And so people who are kind of really afraid of risks are going to look at the bad side of things, spend more time looking at it, and that leads to them, you know, opting to not take the risk. The implications of what we showed is that, and we've demonstrated this now in a couple of studies online, if we physically manipulate, if we just make the possible good stuff bigger or brighter, you know, bigger or brighter font, you spend more time looking at it, and then you're basically shifting your brain to focusing on the possible good stuff than the bad stuff, and you're more likely to take the risk, you're more likely to take the gamble.
It's amazing, but a lot of people would say, you know, that wouldn't apply to me. I'm not going to fall for that trick. But these cues really do make a difference.
Absolutely, and they're subtle too. So it's there's I think the sky's the limit here in terms of what we can do.
So the next question is from Jeff on LinkedIn. Is there such a thing as social brain network overload that begins to impact the way that we operate as leaders? I mean, can that happen when there's just too much going on from that social angle that we discussed?
This is a great question. There is some data that suggests that, well, we know that there's a lot of variation between people in terms of basically how healthy and vital and well connected our own social brain networks are. And so that's kind of puts a capacity limit on kind of the number of relationships that you can manage. And so certainly there can be overload. On the other hand, there are ways to dial up your social brain network and actually make it function better. So things like interacting with new people in the real world, exercising your social brain, doing the things we talked about earlier in terms of really paying attention to folks, et cetera. Now, I think that the moment we're in right now presents some really difficult challenges because we're interacting not really face-to-face, we're interacting online. And, you know, we've heard about Zoom fatigue, and Zoom fatigue seems to be real. It reflects the fact that it's just harder for our social brain networks to get the information we need when we're, you know, seeing people in little tiny boxes on a screen, right? It's just that much harder to kind of pick out micro expressions and where they're looking and things like that. And so for that reason, I think, you know, kind of getting to this overload, it's really important to take breaks and don't overschedule, you know, your Zoom meetings.
Interesting. All right, last question I have as we move to wrap things up comes from Leonard on LinkedIn. Very, very interesting. As you wrote this, what part of it was most challenging? What was the hardest thing to either come up with or to put on paper here?
That's a really interesting question. So I think it's the last chapter, which is about the future of brain science and business. It's, of course, difficult to see the future very clearly. But, you know, it was exciting to write, to really begin to think about how is brain science going to evolve in the way that it interacts with business. And the really critical parts of that chapter are about the ethical, legal, and societal implications, right? So I think many of you probably share my concern that, you know, this is in some ways a Pandora's box. We can do all these amazing things, but you know, with great power comes great responsibility. So, you know, it's got to be put toward the right end. And I think if we're helping people, we're empowering people, that's great. But if we're using these tools to exclude people or in ways that, you know, increase inequality, right? Because if there isn't good, if everyone doesn't have access to these tools, then that's just going to make things worse. And so that's a conversation we have to have as scientists and academics with, you know, the public and with people involved in consumer protection and the law and ethics. And so, you know, we don't have exclusive purchase on that. And that's something everybody should be talking about.
Makes sense. And while indeed the future is hard to predict, just the science is really coming together. It's so interesting to be at an early stage of something just so exciting, so impactful. And so just to truly wrap things up, how's your own research agenda taking shape for the next few years?
Yeah, I mean, so my research is quite broad. As you pointed out, I'm in three schools. And so I kind of have a basic science center, right? So that's where we're doing core basic science research. We have a kind of clinical direction where we try to take some of the insights and knowledge, technologies, therapies, and push that in directions to kind of help people with who have problems with depression, anxiety, both in diagnostics and treatments. But then the other part, which is the sort of business facing, society facing, is saying, how do we put this into practice to create value for companies, customers, and society? And that's really exciting because that's where we're taking neuroscience out of the lab and putting it into the real world and, you know, relying on the, you know, the evolution in wearable devices that allow us to get, you know, brain data in people who are shopping or in people who are at work or who are on the sports field. And it's filling in those gaps, basically. And you know, check in with me in another year or two and we'll have a lot more to say.
And we will do just that. Michael, I hope that a lot of folks are intrigued by our conversation here. We're actually going to post and share a code if people want to get a 40% discount on getting the ebook version of The Leader's Brain. We'll also post some information about the new executive education program that you have. Really, really exciting stuff. And it's just an honor for me to be able to talk to you about it. But there's much more to come. We're going to continue with this Meet the Authors series. I would love you to go to the Wharton School Press website and sign up for the newsletter and for notifications about future events like this, as well as the Wharton School as a whole. Michael, I'm so lucky to have you as a colleague, to learn from you, to have a chance to interact with you like this, and I really appreciate your taking the time.
It's been a pleasure. Feel the same way, Pete.
Thanks very much.
Okay. Thank you, everyone.